Hello and greetings from Berlin, Germany to our viewers today. Welcome to the fourth edition of the Quintessential Tuesdays with Dr. Chris. We are very happy to welcome each and every one of you today on this live webinar featuring Professor Khoury and Dr. Grunder. And our host, as all the Tuesdays this year, is Dr. Chris Köttgen from Mainz. Thank you very much for once again being our host today. Just a little housekeeping rules. We are looking forward to hearing from those two specialists, and we will take questions in between and after each of the lectures. You can ask your questions in the F&A or the Q&A tool. Also, if you are very keen on, you know, asking your question live later on, if the time permits, you can raise your hand and we can have you joining us in the presentation or in the discussion with your camera or your voice. So thank you very much. And Chris, maybe you want to take over from here?
Yes, okay, thank you. Also from Mainz, a warm welcome to webinar number four. It's so nice to have you here again on Zoom and Facebook. And since today is the big opening of our implant blockbuster, I decided to wear a tie to celebrate that day. Believe it or not, last time we had over 570 people watching the webinar live on Zoom. And after that, we had over 4,800 people watching the video on Facebook. And you can do that all the time. All the videos we had till now, and also what we show today, will be on the Facebook from Quintessence. In Germany, movement slowly comes into play of the lockdown. But at the moment, it doesn't necessarily look like it's a better situation for me. Yes, the shops open slowly, but only with prior appointment. It's just like in our offices. So I don't think that an overcrowded fashion store is conducive to the overall situation. But speaking of fashion, do you know Pierre Cardin? He's considered the richest fashion designer in the world. And the question is, how did he do that? It's very easy. His credo in business life was, if you want to fly first class, you have to serve the economy class. That may work in fashion industry, but unfortunately, this trend also exists in implantology. Place as many implants as possible, as quickly as possible, regardless of the bone or the soft tissue. It will hold for 5 years, but after that, no cock crows at it. But there's a crucial difference. I can change a coat or a pair of shoes if I want to, but this is not possible with a brainlessly placed implant. The subtle difference is that we are doctors and we are responsible for this. So what every dentist working in implantology must understand is that there are four pillars of the long-term success of an implant. It's the bone, what we are talking today. It's the soft tissue, it's the implant itself and its prosthetic procedures, and of course its maintenance. So let's start with part one today. It's the bone. And who else than Professor Faud Khoury and Uli Grunder could give us a more in-depth look at this topic. And I want to show, and I want to start with some slides for you. And you know, if you start with a situation like this, you have a tooth which you cannot keep and you have to get it out. So you see there's inflammation and you have to think about everything. You have to think about periodontics. You have to think about the hard tissue, the soft tissue. And what you always do is you start with the planning. In what site you ever do it, but you have to plan. And then you see, this is what we are talking about. We have to discuss about the bone and we have to make thoughts about the soft tissue. And if you see this, we have a big defect here and Uli Grunder and Faud Khoury will show their ways to rebuild the bone. You must find one solution to get a new bone. And then you can come from this situation to a better stable situation. There's another example. You place an implant and there is still bone. But I think if you do nothing and you don't care about this, you might lose the buccal bone. And everyone knows what that means. You can have a good soft tissue, but I think this is a crucial part that problems can start here. So you have to take another solution here, for example, with a bone lamina technique that you get a stable bone situation like you have here. And then also you have to go on with the soft tissue. And there another example, a big bone defect, vertical and horizontal. And then you can take the Khoury technique, what he will go and show you. You take autogenous bone plates, one on the buccal side and one on the palatal side, and you fill that gap with an autogenous bone. And after 3 months, you will come to this result. So this will be a stable situation and a good point to start. There another example, what you're going to see today, the most important thing for you is if you want to have this situation, read those books of Uli Grundem and from Fahd Khoury, because it's necessary to start with a perfect bone if you want to have a long-term success. So we make start with this, and now I give the words back to Christian. And Christian, please introduce Uli.
Perfect. Thank you very much for this nice introduction. Before we go ahead, we cheer. Where's your drink?
Yes.
There you
Cheers,
go. Perfect.
Christian. Cheers, everybody. Take Good. A gin tonic and enjoy.
Looking
the
forward
next
to topics. A great evening of education. Very good. Perfect. So we're very happy to have Uli Grunder with us, who, as you mentioned, is one of our authors who have created this wonderful book a couple of years ago, which is still very much very important publication. And we are also happy to call him a friend. So Uli, you are very welcome. And I'm starting your camera. And if you want to join us, there he is. Perfect.
Here Uli. I am.
Thank
Hello.
You very much.
Yes,
cheers.
Cheers.
Okay, good. So I think we can give the word to Uli and he can start, and then we can have the first discussion after the first lecture. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Perfect. So before we start, we also like to thank our sponsors, Tommen, who are supporting us today for this webinar and the entire implant blockbuster of the four coming episodes. So thank you very much, Tommen.
Thank you very much.
We will share later on with you some of the links also to the publications if you're interested. So Uli, please, there you go.
Welcome everybody. Welcome to Chris. Chris, I thank you very much for organizing this webinar and for inviting me. I think we will have fun. That's one of the ideas. And you asked me to talk about bone augmentation. You will see more the GVR technique. The title is Long-Term Success with Implants, the Influence of Stable Bone. So the picture you see here was the area where I prepared this lecture. This is the Engadine, a beautiful area. Unfortunately, I'm not there anymore. But anyway, so Chris already started a little bit with the topic. And I would like to tell you that I'm have a conflict of interest. I'm advisor and consultant of Tommen Medical. Just to make things clear, you will not hear any brand name during my lecture. So we already have seen an introduction, a before and after. What changed? We changed the crowns, but we changed the volume of tissue. And the fact is, most probably in these cases, we add some bone. In the aesthetic zone, it's so important. This is a single tooth replacement, rather easy case. And this is how it looks like after 5 years. Still there. I think our goal has to be long-term success. And this is what it's all about in this lecture. If it's a little bit more complex, look at this smile line, the before and after. And what we see again, the most obvious change is that we have more volume in tissue. But you cannot do this just with soft tissue. Some people think they can do a lot with soft tissue. Yes, we can, but we need bone. Actually, we need bone and soft tissue. Today, it's mainly bone. It's a vertical bone augmentation to get to this result. And here is already the start and the 7-year result. So sometimes it's even more complex. Look at this. That's how we started. We had a huge defect and we realized an acceptable result. And we have to analyze this case and say, well, it's not perfect, but it's improved. And we have to realize that we have limitations. And if we look at this case, of course, you already know it's a vertical augmentation, much more than the case before. It looks acceptable. And if you look at the long-term result, this is 15 years later. It's not great. We have some scar tissue. Nevertheless, we have rather stable situations. This is actually what we are driving for. On the other hand, we get these referrals. Look at this. Was referred to me, please correct it. That's terrible, because this dentist didn't know how to handle a patient with in the aesthetic zone with a high smile line. There is missing tissue. Of course I can handle it, but there are different ways. And the easiest way to do it is actually prosthetically. That's what we did. But this should not be the goal of our treatment. And that's just another case where you also can see there is not a vertical bone deficit, there is a buccal bone deficit, an incredible deficit. and the patient is very unhappy. And what I want to tell you with this case is actually, I removed the implant. I placed a new implant. I did some bone augmentation, later on a little bit of soft tissue. It's a lot of work if we did it wrong. And look at this, the before and after. This is the final result. But it took me 1 year and 1 month to make this correction. And I also in other countries, but in Switzerland, this is very expensive. So I think it's pretty clear what we should have. Even if we have some bone, but maybe we have a fenestration, if you want to get this result, this is, by the way, is the implant, this result, we need bone, especially in the aesthetic zone. We need the perfect bone volume. And we have to go through a lot of surgeries sometimes, unfortunately. Otherwise, we get the compromised result. And if you look at this result, this pink aesthetic score, I think around this implant is really ideal. It is 14. That means all 7 points get the number two. Number two means it is good. So pink aesthetic score 14, unfortunately, we cannot achieve in every case, but sometimes we do. Now the question really is long-term success with implants. And do we really need this bone, let's say in the aesthetic zone? And there's an interesting study done by Veltri and co-workers, as you can see in 2016. They had only 12 implants. I come back on this problem that we have only a limited number of implants. However, they looked at an average time of 8.9 years at the pink aesthetic score. And the interesting thing is they did 3D x-rays, and they wanted to see whether they really have a buccal bone plate or not. And you see the buccal bone level in average was 3.8 millimeter apical of the implant shoulder. Nevertheless, so they don't have really a lot of bone in the buccal area. Nevertheless, they came to the conclusion that they get acceptable and stable aesthetics, and it was not jeopardized by a thin or missing buccal bone. So why we do all this? Why we do all this? But it's a very nice publication because they do not only give us the number, they actually show us all the 12 cases. I like that. It's fair. Let's look at these cases. Let's look at them very carefully. So you see it's acceptable result. Well, how do we say aesthetics is in the eye of the beholder? These are the first six cases, enjoy them. These are the next six cases. And if you look how they analyze these cases, for example, look at this. They looked, we just take one thing, color versus of the soft tissue versus the adjacent teeth. And they say they have only at reolation, only one case that was not good. All other ones, they were acceptable. Perfect was none of them. Well, I think if I have a case like this, I would not say it's good. If I have a case like this, I would not say it's good. So it's the way how we judge it. If you're happy with that, you don't have to follow this webinar anymore, I think. But if you agree with me, we have nothing like a perfect result. Look at this, the deficit in the Alvarez process. These are concavities, all concavities everywhere there, but they have none that is not good at the reevaluation. Well, it depends obviously how we look at our cases. I think if we have missing bone plate and we want to get these results, we have to have some bone. And that's a clear statement. And we need the bone, as you can see, like a bone balcony around the implant shoulder. We need this bone. We also need soft tissue. This is not the topic today. I will come back on this a little bit at the very end of my lecture. And if we go to a more complex situation, if we have two adjacent implants and you would like to see a papilla in the interproximal area between the two implants, we need to support this soft tissue. This soft tissue by itself does not create a papilla. We need to support it with bone. And this bone has to be the same level as the attachment level of the neighboring teeth. And it has to be more on the buccal side. Why? Look at this papilla. We are interested in the buccal area of a papilla in the aesthetic zone. We don't care if there is a missing papilla on the palatal side. So we have to understand that we have to be able to augment the bone very precise. Look at this case, missing buccal papilla, existing palatal papilla. Two implants, pretty close placed together, and then we augment the bone. And if you look at this, we have a distance of 3 millimeters. Nevertheless, we have extra bone, more buccally in this area. And we should not lose this bone. This is what the topic is all about today. And if you look at how we started once before we extracted the teeth, how the case looks like after 6 and 15 years, we do have the papilla because we augmented the bone in the right position. So one of the topic also is how precise can we work to get the bone where we need it? Sorry, that went back, that was wrong. Well, look at this case. Do we need bone augmentation? Is there a defect? That's a wonderful bone, but you realize that one picture is missing. If we had this picture included as well, you realize that there's a palatal papilla existing and a missing buccal papilla. Look at the bone. There is a missing bone. If you cannot augment this bone predictably, you will never see a papilla at the end. Let's do it. And this is the technique I will come back on it later on. Very precisely, we can augment the bone in the buccal area of the interproximal space between two implants, and we get this papilla occlusal view. You see, we have the volume. Very important. And we have to have a tool that gives us predictable bone. Now, you will see a show. It goes all by itself. I started. You see the before and after. The before and after. I think it's something like, I don't know, 30, 40, 50 cases. I can show you hundreds of cases. Why do I show you this? Well, we have to have a technique that allows us really to create bone on a predictable way. And I think it's very important to understand that you will only be successful if you get doing, if you do the case again and again and again, different cases again with the same technique. And you will see also during the lecture of Professor Khoury, he does his technique every day. That's why he is successful. And my message with all these pictures is, if you have a technique, whatever it is that works, don't change your technique every weekend after you listen to another lecture and you heard something else. If you want to become good, start with easy cases and make tiny little changes in your technique. If you think you have the right technique, tiny little changes to improve. And you improve one thing, and this is also very important, improve speed. What we show you today, and I think it's the same for Professor Khoury's work, if what we show you today, it's very dependent on how it heals, and this is very dependent on how fast you can work. Speed is important. Now, you will see that we will discuss later on GBR technique, IT bone regeneration versus bone augmentation with autogenous bone presented by Professor Khoury. Huh. If I want to be nasty, I show you this case. This was in 1991. We had autogenous bone. They even covered this with a membrane. The result was wonderful after 8 months. I placed the implants and I reopened it another 6 months. Oops, look at that. The bone is gone. What did we do? Well, if I show you this picture, I can say, don't use autogenous bone. What did we do? We harvested bone blocks from the chin. This is cortical bone, that material. So what I want to show you is this, bone augmentation with autogenous bone is not all the time the same technique. Because if I show this, I know exactly, you can't see him, but he's behind his computer. Look at him. He said, but my God, of course they cannot work because this is not the Khoury technique. So I think it's very important if we discuss augmenting bone, whether it's autogenous bone or GBR, what kind of GBR, what kind of autogenous bone. And I would like to start with the GBR is my topic. GBR is not a new thing. If we look at this, it was actually published in 1989, goes to 79 different publications for medical doctors. And they told us that the barrier is very important to preserve and protect the blood clot, very important, and to make sure that no soft tissue gets in this defect. So that's it. We need a membrane to protect the blood clot. And if we look at this, also, if we talk about the type of defect that can make the difference, this is a space maintaining or a volume stable defect. Very easy. Berlin presented this in 1988. So if you have a blood clot inside, you place a membrane or no membrane, you get bone, full bone defect. In the aesthetic zone, unfortunately, it's totally different what we have most often. We have a flat surface and we want to create new bone. We call this de novo bone formation or neo-osteogenesis. This was published with the supraplant in 1991 by Schmid and co-worker.
So this is very demanding from the biological point of view. And if we talk about GBR, and I would like to share with you a very old case where we had some tenting screw and non-resorbable membrane, and we get this volume. And what is underneath the membrane? Blood clot, nothing else, blood clot. And if we look at the result after 8 months, this is all bone. And my message is, it's all about the membrane. The membrane is the key factor for GBR. And actually, you can see what we did once. This is how it looks like after 15 and 20 years. I want to show you the volume, how stable this volume is 20 years later. This is the most important picture I show you during my lecture about GBR. GBR is functioning because we have a blood clot, we protect it. We have to make sure that we can maintain the space. We can stabilize the blood clot, and then it needs time. Four things, very easy. And then we have to discuss what we are going to try to augment, the defect type. Look at this type. This is an easy defect. Two bone walls. It's a very small defect. We get information for the existing bone all around in this area, and we get new bone. If you want an extra bone further out here, you need extra time. But this is an easy defect. If you look at this defect, it's totally different. Look at this existing bone. That's where the information comes from, that the bone is growing in the blood clot. We should not forget that. And it takes more time. It's more, there is a bigger distance from here to here. So we need a membrane that is functioning over a long term. And if we look at this, this is a vertical horizontal defect. We have to stabilize it additionally. There is also a membrane on top later on. We have to, we ask Mother Nature to do something totally different. It's much more difficult to get this new bone, and we need time. And I like this picture very much to share with you. It's a defect. I augmented 6 months later, I removed the membrane, and this is the result. What can you see? This is good bone, but look at this. What is this? This is xenograft remaining. And if you look at the defect I had and the defect that is remaining, it's a total parallel thing, though that means the bone is growing in from here. And if I would wait another 1 or 2 months, this would be bone as well. It shows time is important, and the time depends on the size of the defect you want to fill in with new bone. Now we have different membranes. We have the one, non-resorbable one, with titanium reinforcement as we like it today. You can decide how long it will be in function. We have a cross-linked collagen membrane. This resorbs more or less between 6 and 8 months. And then we have the native collagen membrane that resorbs after 6 to 8 weeks. This is the membrane that is most often used, most often without any effect. So I prefer this one because we can shape it in 3 dimensions. Space maintaining, you remember, one of the 4 points. You can perfectly shape what you want. You can work very precisely, and you can decide how long it has to be in function. Just one example, no bone buckley. We place this, we use the xenograft. I come back on this later on. We place the membrane, a second layer. That's how we do it today, because we have to close the gaps between the non-resorbable membrane and existing bone. We have an 18 collagen membrane. We wait 6 months. Here is the bone. And look at this. This is the smile line, by the way. This is the crown. So we get what we need. If we have a defect like 2 adjacent implants, well, we need the same membrane. The bigger the membrane, the better. Don't forget. The bigger the framework, the easier it is. There are a lot of details I cannot discuss during this short lecture. However, we can make an extra cut and look again how precise I can bend it. I can get the perfect curve. I can do what I need to get what I want. For example, 2 adjacent implants. I want my extra bone further out here. We have my xenograft. I can create the balcony. This is the result. Look at the new bone. You see, I augmented above my implant shoulders. It's something like 3 millimeters. I have this special bone here, and I get my perfect papilla. So this is actually what we want to do. I know a lot of people are afraid because of failures. This was the old EPTFE membrane. And if we did a lousy job, by the way, I did it by myself, this lousy job, it's very lousy suturing, attention, I get an exposure, it's a disaster. Nowadays, we have different, we have not the EPTFE anymore, we have the dense PTFE. This has porosities, the new one has no porosities. And what we see, if we have a failure with this case, I can show you. I have 2 tenting screws. I augmented bone. This was a staged approach with a xenograft. Here you see adaptation of the membrane. Second layer, native collagen membrane, as I just told you, nice adaptation of the soft tissue, no problem. The patient went back to South Africa. She came back after 4 months. And this is how it looked like. This is a disaster, but with the old membrane, I would have a lot of pus here, nothing. So I removed the membrane. You can see there is some existing new tissue. I waited another 2 months, and that's how I once started at the very beginning before I did my bone augmentation. And this is the result, even if I had an exposure of the membrane. I just want to show you that with the new membrane, if you have a failure, a complication, it's less dramatic. Now, I can do it one more time because there's still missing bone. I do it one more time with the same technique. 6 months later, I have my bone and this is the final result. However, I wanted to show you what the difference is between the EPTFE with porosities and the new dense, highly dense membrane. Do we need a filler, a xenograft? We don't need it, I showed you, but it makes our life much easier. So we use this collagen mixture normally of a bovine bone mineral. I place it here. I like this very much because I can define the size and it helps me to support the membrane in the right position and then I get my bone. So we have to understand if I use, regarding the fillers, if I use a space maintaining membrane, I can use this rather fluffy filler because the membrane itself is space maintaining thanks to the titanium framework. If you use a resorbable, not space-maintained membrane, you should use a more stable, even if these are particles, it's more stable, you cannot compress it, a filler. You have to combine it correctly. But most of the people I know, they use this to do some GBR. How successful can we really be? I just give you one clinical example. Look at this. This is the defect. I have the xenograft, so-called almost space-maintaining. I have a native collagen membrane resorbs in 6 to 8 weeks. And this is the result. You don't, most people, they don't open it anymore, the flap, but look at this. This is not really bone. And if you look at this case 4 years later, all of a sudden I have a broken depth down, no buccal bone plate. And I had to remove the implant and start all over again. So the problem is if you have a short-term membrane that is only functioning in a short term, you don't really get great bone. I like this publication very much. It was about soft tissue xenografts, but look at this. What they did, and it's a nice setup, they placed the implants that they had this bone defect. Box type, these are box type defects. Then they filled in a xenograft and the native collagen membrane was covered everything and they closed it. They allowed for healing. And then after healing, they placed soft tissue grafts. And later on they did the histological examination. So they look at the soft tissue graft here, but you remember we had some exposed thread. We have some bone augmentation with a native collagen membrane and xenograft. And now, yes, look here. These are the four pictures, they were in publication. And indeed, here is a little bit of bone, but what's about the rest? Hey, there is no bone because this technique did not create bone. Remember, we had the threads exposed and they're still exposed. No xenograft is left. Here is a tiny little bit of xenograft and is a tiny little bit of new bone. Clinical case, if I augment with a native collagen membrane, the whole buccal area here with a xenograft and I reopen it later on, what I see quite often is that it is just a xenograft embedded in soft tissue. And if you have bad luck, you know, over the time, this xenograft pops out of the soft tissue and we call this a popcorn machine because it pops out one after the other. So you don't really get bone. Another problem published by Nanny is if you have a resorbable membrane, which is not space maintaining, comparing to the non-resorbable space maintaining membrane. Well, look at the volume they had after they augmented, just immediately after augmentation procedure, and how much was left on the buccal volume. So they lost actually with the resorbable non-space maintaining 65% of the volume. Whereas with the space maintaining membrane, they lost 5%. So it collapsed. This is the real problem. On the other hand, what do we get if we do this kind of bone augmentation? Well, I did a small little study or let's say a case report. I had 8 patients where we augmented the bone. And after augmentation, I harvested tiny little pieces, as you can see, in the most buccal area. And Peter Schüppach, he did the histology. And in the histology, what he could do is actually he could separate the vital bone and the xenograft, and we find out how much vital bone we have, new bone, and how much xenograft, and how much, these are blood vessels, these are fat cells and everything else, is existing. So you can see we have a big range between the cases. In average, however, we have something like 50% of new bone. In the most buccal area of our newly regenerated tissue, we have something like 90% of xenograft, and the rest is others. Well, is this good bone? I would like to compare this results with a study done by Nevins. Nevins actually showed us, he had 8 patients where they had extraction sockets, so a 4 bone wall defect. They filled in the same xenograft, they added some growth factor, they submerged it, and they checked after 4 and 6 months what kind of quality of bone they have. And if we compare this, don't forget they had a growth factor included, they had a 4 bone wall defect, very easy defect, comparing to the novel bone formation. And look at the results. New bone, almost the same, 18-15%. Xenograft, 70-90%, and others, pretty much the same. And that's why I tell you we have good bone. Now, if you want to work with a resorbable membrane, which does not last very often, you can speed up, and we have seen this with the growth factor, speed up by adding growth factors. Bone morphogenic protein exists in autogenous bone. Now, if you want to do this with a resorbable membrane, you have to add autogenous bone. You have to speed up the process and mix it together with your xenograft. And this is just one case. If we have huge defects, look at these implants. They are not in the bone here, not at all. They are in bone here, but there's no bone. So I have to have something that allows me to work space maintaining. That's why I add this titanium framework. And then I add some bone mixture with xenograft. This is autogenous bone chips and the xenograft. And then I work with resorbable membranes, and I can speed up the process or make sure that bigger defects can be filled in as well, because we have a limitation with the GBR technique. This, by the way, is the new bone, but I waited 8 months because it's a huge distance. Look at this. This is how I started. The implants were almost not in the bone, and I have a big bone, but I speeded up or improved the situation by adding some autogenous bone chips. But the standard procedure is really this. As you have seen, we place the implants. We can do it almost all the time simultaneously, which is very important. As long as I can stabilize my implant, I'll do it. I use the xenograft, not space maintaining, a titanium reinforced membrane, which I can bend perfectly in every dimension. And second layer is a native collagen membrane just to close the gaps between this membrane. Just one other case, 2 implants are placed. I need extra bone buckle, as you already know. I perfectly stabilize my membrane. Underneath, I have a xenograft. I can bend the perfect shape what I want. I want to have a papilla later here in this area. I place a second layer of native collagen membrane. I close the flap, which is the most important thing in the whole procedure. We allow for healings normally 6 months. After 6 months, if I reopen it, the membrane is still there. I have to remove the membrane. We have extra bone. Oops, where are the implants? So we have extra bone above the implants because we augmented above this the cover screws. I have to relocate my implants, as you can see here. Now you just can see it. Now you can see the extra bone in the interproximal area. And look at this. Look how much bone I augmented above my implant shoulder. The cover screw is another millimeter. So these are 3 millimeters extra bone to support this papilla. This is the day when I place my crowns. This is the final result. And I can show you the result after 5 years. And I'm pretty sure I can show you the same result after 10 and 20 years. So this is more or less what we do. The most important thing, and what most people make the mistakes, is flap adaptation. And it's very important, very difficult sometimes. Look at this. This is a very thin, soft tissue. And you know how much is missing after I augmented a huge amount of new material? Missing is 1.5 centimeter. So you have to make a release incision. And this, of course, Professor Khoury will tell you the same. This is the key factor for success. Look at this. This is how I sutured. It's very nicely adapted with 7-0 suture. This is how the case looks like after 1 day. You almost can remove the sutures after 1 day. Remember, very thin soft tissue. This is how it looks like after 6 months. So I could change the case from here to here. This is the new bone, the final result. I would like to share with you two very quick videos. It's the same actually. Well, we can do it. Even we have a limited amount of bone. This is something like 2 millimeter thick bone. And if I have the right tool, the right implant, I can place my implants. But this is not an easy thing to do. Look at this. There's no bone in the buccal area. No. To stabilize this implant is not easy. Drilling for the next one. Look at this. I just lose the entire buccal bone wall. I also have almost no bone on the palatal side. And now it takes actually a lot of force and a little bit of experience to stabilize this implant, even if you have no buccal bone plate. Make sure that you place your implants in the perfect position and direction. If I can do this, I can augment my bone with the GBR technique I just showed you, always simultaneously. So the two implants are placed now, and now we go on and we find out what we do with the membrane. You can see I already cut the membrane. I have a big framework. The bigger the framework, the better, because I want to have support of the existing bone. I have to stabilize my membrane. There are different ways. That's not the topic today. However, we have to stabilize the membrane perfectly. I can add my xenografts. I don't want a xenograft. I want to stabilize a blood clot. So I make sure that there is enough blood there. And then I suture it toward the palatal. Just make sure that this membrane is perfectly stabilized. Remember, space maintaining, stabilization of the blood clot, and then time. This is the key. So suturing and stabilizing of this membrane, it takes quite a lot of time. But as I told you before, if an operation like this, just the operation, takes you more than an hour, you have a high risk that you have a bad healing. And this, I tell you, was a very difficult case because we have terrible soft tissue to work with. Now, this is the second layer. It's a native collagen membrane. I just laid in place. You don't have to stabilize it additionally because once it gets wet, it stays in place. Just make sure that small little openings between the existing bone and the not resorbable membrane are covered properly. And then we have to suture it. I cannot show you this. It takes too much time, however. Suture it perfectly after the release incision. This is how I started. Look at the different soft tissue. This is just the case when I finished suturing, positioning suture, adaptation suture, and this is how it healed after 6 months. And by the way, this is the final result. These are the two implants. This is how the patients look like. So some cases we cannot do simultaneously. What we do then, because I cannot stabilize the implants here. Well, we do pretty much the same. This is a vertical defect, horizontal defect. I actually need a little piece of autogenous bone, as you can see. I harvest this from the spine because I already have an open flap here. It's very easy to take it with a trefine. I stabilize it here for two reasons. One reason is now I have some bone perforating protein that gives me some information. The other reason, and this is the main reason, I have a good support for my membrane. Instead of an implant, I have this stable bone block. It's a very small bone and it's calcaneus bone, but most of them is sponges bone. So it's good bone. And then we do what I did showed you before, xenograft, membrane one, membrane two. Oops, sorry, that goes to membrane one, membrane two. We allow for healing, nothing new. This is how what I see after 6 months. Now I can place my implants. It's great bone. And of course, in the acidic zone, I augment one more time with a cross-linked collagen membrane. However, I could change the case from here to here, vertically, horizontally. Look how much we gain. And this is the when I place my crown. And this is how we started once. And this is already the 5-year result. Okay. But the title of today is Long-Term Success with Implants. So what do we know? What do we see in the literature? I just will tell you we have a big problem. There is few systematic reviews. I just show you one systematic review out of two published in 2015. And they found that long-term results, at least over 5 years, a randomized controlled clinical trial to find out whether the augmented bone is still stable, they found only one publication. And there was the publication of Ronnie Young. So he showed us that the PEG membrane, this is a very special membrane, the liquid membrane that should become stiff. This was the only study that was included, how good they performed. Unfortunately, 1 year later, there was another publication that showed that with this membrane, they did not get predictable bone, and nobody ever could buy this membrane because he never came on the market. We have other systematic reviews, and the results is always no long-term evidence of stable bone after guided bone regeneration. Even a consensus conference said we only have short-term evidence, limited evidence. And the newest one I could find is 2016, since there was no systematic review published anymore. And they find a trend that it is after vertical guided bone regeneration, more or less a stable bone over 4 to 5 years. So how frustrating is this? On the other hand, of course, you can see a lot of publication. This was the original publication where they showed whether you have a resorbable or a non-resorbable membrane, what is better. And what they did, and this was done in the 90s, they actually placed implants, they augmented buccally some bone with a resorbable or non-resorbable membrane. But unfortunately, they came to the result that they gave that it doesn't matter what kind of membrane you're going to use. But look what they did. First of all, the study had always a problem. They did not measure the defects. They don't talk about defects, but the kind of defects has a tremendous impact on what we get. And then they did place immediate implants, used additionally non-resorbable membranes, and not surprising, had 44% of exposures. What the hell we want to do with these results? You know, if you use either of this technique, the way they used it, you don't get bone. So the message is, if you look at this, is the these are the 14-year results. Now they have the more 20-year result, and they are still successful if they look at their X-rays mesial distal, where they had no bone defects. How, by the way? The message is, if bone augmentation is not functioning, you still are successful. But they only look whether the implants are still there or not. So we can't do it. On the other hand, can't use these studies. On the other hand, look at these studies. If you have 23 patients, 38 patients, every result is a random result. So if you go in statistic, people, they will love on this because they said, well, what can you show with this? You know, not enough patients. The result is we don't know. And the problem again is, if you look at these cases, look at the type of bone defect. If we compare these cases and we put them in a study, you need thousands of cases because you compare pears and apples and all other fruits. It's not the same thing. It really depends. What can I show you? Long-term results. Well, I can show you a case with a huge defect. We augmented. It was a pontic area. And 15 years and more, the patient had an accident. It was a lady. She lost all the teeth. And I had the chance to place some implants. And look at this was the area where we augmented 15 years earlier a vertical defect. So I took the chance. I harvested some little piece out of here. And the proof is here. The white stuff, also done by the histology by Peter Schipper. The white stuff is the xenograft and the red is vital bone. So there is still xenograft in a depth of 3.5 millimeter in average, let's say like this. And if you look at this picture, and it's a unique picture, you see always the white stuff xenograft, the red stuff is vital bone. And this is the xenograft, this is the vital bone, and there is no action visible of changing. There is no resorption, there are no osteoclasts. If I believe in Peter Schüppach, and he is the best histological guy I ever know, it's a great result. At least we know we get stable result. Well, we published a study as well, not a long-term result. It's a one-year result together with my partner, David Schneider. We did 16 cases in the office. We made impressions on every step before placing the implant, after placing the implant, after healing, and when finalizing the crane at the crown. We looked at the result by digitizing always the interesting area, and they could at the university overlap it and find out that way you lose volume or we gain volume in this area. We came to these results. As you can see, the most important thing is here, once we finished and we looked at the case of 1 year later, we lost from the buccal volume, we augmented with bone and soft tissue. Don't forget the soft tissue. We lost only a little bit, 3%. And then the people came up to us and said, hey, come on, you have now time. You can publish a 10 or 15 year result of these cases. It would be very interesting. Would it be? 16 cases, these are random results. Why did we never publish this? Why would I not look at this? Look at these cases. This is one of the cases. We augmented the bone and we get a beautiful result. It looks good. But look at this result after 10 years. Because we have seen some resorption. Now, if we tell the bone is not stable, that's wrong. Look at the position of the implant. We placed these implants too far buccally and then we start losing bone. So we cannot say it was the bone that did not last. It was the implant that was in wrong position. That's why we lost the bone. So we never published it. If you look at this case, perfect implant position, bone augmentation, we get the perfect papilla, everything is here, 2 years, 5 years, I can come back in another 20 years and it's still there. So there are so many parameters we have to take into consideration if we want to talk about long-term results. I can show you long-term results, but these are case reports. So you can see here, implant is placed, some exposed threads, new bone after 6 months. This is how we finished the case. It looks pretty nice. 5 years, 10 years, and now I can make a jump, 22 years. We see some elongation of the natural tooth, but look at this volume, perfect stable. So I can show you with cases, if we place the implant in a perfect position, and if we do the bone augmentation, that it will last 20 up to, I have cases up to 30 years. But there's a but. If we look at this case, there is no papilla here. We want to create the papilla. I place only one implant, but I augmented extra bone in this area, as I told you before. Here's the new bone. Look at the amount of bone I have above my implant shoulder. Then we add some soft tissue, as we do in almost all the cases in the aesthetic zone. And here is the new tissue. Now, this is the final result. Oops, where is my papilla? If I look at this, I would say, meh. The bone maybe is not stable. But if we wait now, and I can show you this picture after 5 years, hey, here's the papilla. What happens? We learned that soft tissue starts growing in some cases. This is another topic. You will talk not about soft tissue, but we have to talk about soft tissue if you look at our cases from the clinical point of view. What about the bone? Is it stable or not? We don't know. Because maybe it's the soft tissue that fills in and it might create even a problem. Look at the soft tissue is growing, and it doesn't look good anymore after 15 years. So if we only look at the volume we have a problem. And that's why I show you this case where we place the implants not entirely in the bone and I augment it with the GBR technique. And of course we damage the soft tissue by ablating the flap. We have non-catheterized mucosa here, as you can see. This is the new bone, and I'd add some soft tissue and I corrected the soft tissue. Okay. Now, this is how what we did. We focus on one implant. I can show you each implant. Let's focus on the implant in the first premolar area. No bone buccally. I have something like 4 millimeters of bone, and this is the clinical picture. Now, more than 19 years later, I did some 3D X-ray. Well, whether you can trust it, it's bone or not, I don't know. However, we can for sure say that out of this 4 millimeters of bone, there is a maximum of maybe 2 millimeters, maybe a little bit less of bone remaining, because this is exactly the area. So I should have a deficit here, but let's look at the clinical picture. And let's not forget that I did some soft tissue grafting as well. This is what I can see. So I lost bone, I gained soft tissue thickness, and this is what our problem is. We don't know if we only look at it from the clinical point of view, whether we have a deficit or not. So summarize, I think we all realize that there is a need of bone augmentation in the aesthetic zone if you want to change the case from here to here. It's a big need of bone augmentation. With the GBR technique, and this is the same case, I can do it even if I have only limited bone available, I can do it simultaneously. Look, I just can stabilize them. And I can use my first membrane, second membrane, close it. A couple of months later, I have my bone and I can change the smile from this to this. It's still the same patient. So there's a need for bone augmentation, that's for sure. Sometimes I need additionally support for my membrane. That's why I take a little piece of autogenous bone. Normally I can take it out of the spinal nasus here, as you can see. So we have to adapt the technique. Everything else is the same, xenograft, two membranes, nothing else. And then we can get beautiful bone. I can place my implant now. So it's still GBR, but slightly adapted. And here you can see that I augment one more time when I place the implant. I always augment bone. And additionally, I need some soft tissue. This is the final result. And what I can show you is at least how the case looks like after 10 years, still there. And this is the picture after 17 years so far. So what we should not forget, if you want to create new bone, it's all about the membrane if you use the GBR technique. Don't forget this. Protect blood clots, space maintaining, stabilization and time. And if we do so, we can vertically augment, as you can see here, this is when I started. If you use the right membrane, this is it, you get this new bone. If you're looking from an occlusal view, again, the membrane makes the difference. This is the new bone. After 8 months, takes time. And then I can change a case from something like that to a 10-year result like that, 15-year result like that, and we still have a perfect papilla in the middle of the case. To summarize the GBR, it depends on the type of defect. If you have a very favorable defect with two bone walls, you might be successful with a short-term functioning membrane as this, if you have the right filler. If the defect is bigger, you might need a space-maintaining, longer-lasting membrane. Well, I'm pretty sure you will do it. Use a filler. If you have a huge defect, I'm very happy to speed up the process by adding autogenous bone, and I also need it as a support for my membrane. The rest is the same, xenograft, non-space-maintaining, non-resorbable membrane, and the second layer. And if you have a really great defect, a huge defect, you need to add some autogenous bone to speed up the process. You need maybe another tool to stabilize everything, or you go with the Curie technique. And I'm very happy that I can listen to this Curie technique by Professor Curie itself in the next lecture. And I would like to thank you very much for listening. Thank you. Chris, it's up to you.
Yes, thank you very much, Oli. This was, as expected, a great lecture, because it shows a real predictable way how you create bone. And for me, this was also very interesting that it is so complicated to have good studies to tell you what makes a long-term success. But I think we all agree, if you don't have good bone or good bone quality and you lose your bone, then you will have not a very good chance to have a good long-term result. But what I want to all of the audience say, there are many, many questions to Uli Gründer. And normally we go on asking all the questions to the authors, but in this case, I would prefer to have first the lecture of Professor Curie, because he has, you know, there's not only one way leading to Rome. There are many ways. And I want to show you a completely other way, with the same intents, but please first listen to Professor Curie, and when he finishes his lecture, we are going to discuss all the questions. I hope this is okay for you. And Christian, it would be very nice if you introduce Professor Curie and we listen to his lecture. And Uli, again, thank you very much for this time. And we are going to discuss that later.
Thank you very much, also Professor Curie, of course, dear Fuad, thank you for joining us tonight. Your microphone is still out. You want to turn on your microphone, maybe?
Okay, great.
Camera. Okay, here's my camera.
Well, that's working.
Thank you very much for taking the time and joining us and following our invitation. We are very much looking forward to your lecture. We are happy to have you as an author for many years now, and we are in the last stages of updating or having the new edition of your book available in English and hopefully soon in many other languages. So I think this is, of course, a very rudimentary summation. You are also involved in some of our editorial boards from our journals. So we are very happy to have been working with you for many, many years. So thank you very much, Fuad, for joining us tonight and for the past years. And we are looking forward to your lecture.
Okay, thank you very much, Christian. Thank you, Chris. And thank you, Uli, for your great lecture, you know, you are really a perfectionist. You was always a perfectionist and you will stay a perfectionist. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to share with Ole Gründer and Quintessence this session. And you saw excellent pictures because Ole Gründer is a really, I know him since many, many years. We are lecturing, we were lecturing several times at different meetings, and he is planning every year an excellent meeting in St. Moritz, where you have the chance also to go for skiing there, I think every two years, I'm sorry. And because of Corona, I think it was postponed. So I can tell you it's an excellent meeting. So I'm going to talk about similar topic, but with another possibility, with another thing. And not only I'm going to talk in the front tooth area, but in the whole area of the mouth. Then, because implantology is not only used in the front teeth area. We have to place implants for aesthetics, for function, and we are looking for long-term stability. Bone is really very important to have long-term stability. So as Christian has told you already, these are my old books and this is the new one, and I hope is going to come on the market at the beginning of the summer. So many things what I'm going to talk about, you will find it in the book. So everybody is looking to have success. And Ole Gründer show you very nice pictures, long-term stability, because long-term stability is a very important point for success. We are not looking for success for 1 year or for 2 years. You know, every time I see a study, 1 year study, what is this 1 year study? With five patients, this is nothing. So we need to see studies with long-term stability. And this is very difficult. Very difficult to have comparative studies, because if you are working with a technique and it functions, you are not going to make experiment on your patient and try to compare it to another technique. That's why, as Uli said, it was very difficult to find comparative studies for long-term, because they are not existing and they are not going to exist. You will see only studies, case studies, long-term studies with, of course, we have a lot, but comparative study are very difficult to control them for a long term. So aesthetic, as you see it here, this is more than 20 years later. This is full-time restoration. Also, a lot of bone augmentation were done here 18 years later. So this is also a success, still functioning quite well, aesthetically and function and long-term stability. And even in patient with severe perio, you see a case with severe perio. Look how the teeth are looking. If you are able to reinstruct the patient, if you are able to follow some biological process in your treatment and how to deal with this patient, it's also possible to reconstruct the lost bone and to have a full mouth restoration as you see it here. In this case, the dentist make a telescopic rounds, but 14 years later, see where we start and what is today possible. So the question is, how much bone do we need really to have long-term stability? Because we said that long-term stability is very important. This is what we are looking for. You know, I'm telling my patient what we are doing now must stay good the whole life. And you must pay attention to what you are talking about, the whole life I'm talking about. So that's why if you have enough bone, if you have enough native bone, we have to pay attention to have peri-implant bone at least 1 millimeter. And today, many people are talking about 2 millimeters remaining bone. So what we see here, it could be the perfect situation. And this was described already by Peter Tage, you see, in 1986. So this is not new. We know this since many, many years. But this is not always possible. We don't have always the ideal bone thickness, the ideal bone height. And if you try to make some experiments, you hear a nice lecture and you think that you can do the same thing and you are not following biological principles, you can have such a results as you see it here. And these are really disaster if you have something like this in the front tooth area. In the molar area, the patient can accept this and this can stay stable for a long term if it can be keep it clean. But front tooth area, this is a disaster. And you have to pay attention to understand what you are doing. Of course, we have different ways to get our success. And we saw in the lecture of Uli Gründer that he can have excellent result, but don't forget he has a lot of experience with this. Even if something is looking easy, this surgery is not easy. Believe me, what he is doing is not easy. Need a lot of surgical skills, need a lot of intelligence, and need a lot of perfectionism. So why we need this bone? What? Why every time we are preparing a flap, it's a danger for the bone? Because every time we are releasing a flap, we are cutting the blood support coming from the periosteum and from the soft tissue. So you see here, blood vessel coming from, beautiful blood vessel coming from the soft tissue, because don't forget, you are preparing a cavity. During the cavity preparation, you are destroying a lot of blood vessels running inside the bone. And if you kill the blood vessels coming from the soft tissue and the periosteum, you will have always bone resorption. This bone resorption can be 10%, can be 15%, can go up to 30% after only releasing a flap. So there are a lot of publication about this in the literature. I'm not going to bother you with the literature. So that's why many authors are recommending something like minimal invasive approach, or sometimes flapless. So minimal invasive approach without exposing all the bone, you can do it if you are sure you that you have a lot of bone, like in this case, and you don't have areas of undercut. So if you have something like this, you don't need to make a big flap, you don't need to make a releasing incision, and so you will keep the vascularization of your bone intact. And so the bone will be stable. Look to this case, 17 years later, nothing changed. Papillas are perfect. The bone is perfect. Okay, but don't pay attention. This, you can do it every time. This, you can do it because you have a lot of bone. We have 8-9 millimeters of bone thickness. So flapless surgery can be very difficult and very dangerous. Look to this. This was flapless surgery because the surgeon saw the crest was looking quite well and he didn't realize that we have intensive part of this crest with area of undercut. And look what is the result. This is flapless surgery. So if you want to make flapless surgery, you should do it only after getting a good diagnostic with a template, guided template on computer. So then it's possible to make flapless surgery and to have success, but you need a lot of bone. So requirement for long-term peri-implant stability, we need bone volume. And but also not only bone volume, we need good bone quality. Vascular support is very important because don't forget, we are working in the oral cavity in a contaminated area. So you can't compare this to bone grafting in orthopedic surgery, where the flap is at the end, closed completely and is going to be never exposed. After we are going to insert our implant, we have to expose them after a certain time. And so you will have contact with the oral flora. And if your bone has a bad vascularization, so the long-term stability will be difficult. So soft tissue is very important. I am going to talk about this. Proper surgery, very important. And we saw this in the lecture of Uli. Proper surgery. This is, you know, if you are not able to remove a wisdom tooth correctly, so don't try to make bone augmentation. So it will be very difficult to have a success. And restorative concept, of course. And at the end, recall. A very important thing, and plaque control. To be able to keep the result, what you get after 1 year or after 2 years, to keep it all over the time. So, unfortunately, we don't have always beautiful bone that we are able to make flapless surgery, or we are able to make surgery without exposing the bone. Many times after tooth extraction, you have a situation like this, or like this, or like this. Look, the heavy atrophy, or like this, or after accident, you have a situation like this. And then you need to do something. What do we have for alternatives if we don't have enough bone thickness and you don't want to make bone augmentation? So some people are telling us today, and the industry also are pushing a lot on that, on implant with reduced diameter and showing them as alternative. That's what's written here in German language in our advertising, that the patient are going to be very happy with that. My dear friend, this is absolutely wrong, because don't forget, implant started in the 50s with implant with reduced diameters. And then we forget them because we had a lot of problems. You know, an implant must support something. You can't put an implant with 1.8 or 2 millimeters diameter to support something. And we see a lot of problems with these cases. Many patients are referred with broken implant or with lost implant because the material stability didn't change really. In the 50s, we were working with titanium. And today, we're still working with titanium. Okay, we have some new alloys, but you are not changing the material 100%. So think about it. This cannot give you long-term stability. And unfortunately, we see this every day. So we are using such an implant with reduced diameter, yes, as temporary implant. When we do heavy bone augmentation, as you see it here, the patient are not allowed to wear any removable prosthesis. We are using this implant with a reduced diameter as temporary implant to offer the patient the possibility to have a fixed bridge. But many times we see after very short time fractures. Look here, this is only 8 weeks after the restoration. These implants are still there, but these two are broken already after 8 weeks. And we published this, you know, in the year 2001. We published that we had with this implant is a good possibility, of course, in case of intensive bone augmentation, to offer to the patient the possibility to have a temporary restoration. But pay attention. Don't trust it too much. You know, we know also with implant with standard, diameter. For example, if we take the Brånemark implant, 3.75 millimeter diameter with external hex. This is, I think, the most stable implant from the mechanical point of view. And even these implants, if you don't pay attention with your occlusal concept, they can break. But the fracture is not coming after 1 year or 2 years. Fracture is coming after 7 years, and we call it fatic fracture. So if this implant can break, so what you are expecting from implant with reduced diameter? Look here, implant with standard diameter broken because of bruxism. Here, other implant. And every patient will be one day a bruxist with the time. You have all to think about this. So that's why if we are talking about long-term stability with implant with reduced diameter is very difficult from fracture point of view. But this study showed also in 2015 that not only they are fracturing, but also they have much more marginal bone loss and failures. So don't follow the advertising of the companies and of some authors who want to sell more implants. You have to think about the dynamic, about the biophysics, about the material. You know, why God give us molars with diameter of 8-9 millimeters if it is possible to restore the molar area with 2.5 millimeters implant? And another point is the emergence profile. Look to that. Disaster with implant with reduced diameter, my friend. Think about this. Very easy to remove them. They were not really osseointegration in this case. So if we want to reconstruct the bone, we need a predictable technique. Uli Gründer showed you the predictable technique in his hand to be able to have a long-term stability. And this technique must be reproducible. And to be reproducible, it must be based on biological principles. Low complication rates. You have to see how it's possible to have low risk of graft exposure. Low morbidity, shortening treatment time. You know, this is something of what, that's why we don't like to use a lot of membranes. You know, Uli Gründer is right when he said that only the non-resolvable membrane is the membrane what you can trust for the long-term stability on to have a good bone regeneration. He's right, and we had the same experience. But you have to wait a long time. Sometimes Urban is waiting 1 year. And this is something, how to get the patient. So wait 1 year, and sometimes you have to re-augment. And another point, low material fees. When I see some friends today are showing technique what you have to invest about 2,000 euros only on materials. So you have, who is going to get the money at the end? The guy who did the surgery or the companies? So all these points, you have to think about them. That's why we trust only autogenous bone, and this since many, many years. Of course, autogenous bone is not always autogenous bone. You have to know how to deal with it, how to work with it. You have to understand the biology of healing and follow biological principles. Here, for example, look at this defect in the anterior area. A lady, vertical bony defect, about 7-8 millimeters. We are going to harvest the bone from the retromolar area to prepare it with such a manner here. This is what we call 3D reconstruction, to fill the box with bone chips. And look how nice this looks like only after 3 months, because it is bone. We are using from the beginning bone, and we are going to get bone. And look how nice this looks like, this quality. And if you drill inside, you will see that it's going to bleed, excellent bleeding. So we insert our implant, and you see the implant on the same bone level, or this bone is the same bone level of the neighboring teeth. The implant is good, surrounded by nice bone. We see the case after 7 years, this is the implant, and the case after 15 years. This patient is now 76 years old. We didn't make only this implant. You see here, we augment also here, we augment also here, you get also implants here. But I want to show you these pictures here. 15 years later, the bone didn't move. So you have to know how to deal with autogenous bone. I will show you another case treated in 92. A student in Münster, bicycle accident, lost this tooth, lost the bone, lost the soft tissue, lost the attachment of this tooth. So, and he had some wisdom teeth with the surgery of removal of wisdom tooth. We harvested the bone in one piece. We grafted here. After 3 to 4 months, we insert the implant. This is 2 years later. This is the implant. This is the natural tooth. This is 7 years later. Implant and natural tooth. And this is 22 years later. Nothing changed. Of course, we augment also the soft tissue, not only the bone. But and later the patient lost this tooth here because of internal resorption. That was the tooth who lost the at the beginning, the attachment. But look here, 22 years and still stable results. So for this, you have to understand, first of all, the anatomy. Look to your anatomy books, because it's very important if you want to make bone augmentation and to be successful, you have to be expert in anatomy to know where you can harvest bone. Second, you have to read your physiology book during the studying. Go and reopen this book to understand how the things are functioning, how a graft is going to be revascularized with what we called here the cutting cone, from where the blood vessels are coming, what the role of osteoclast. Osteoclasts are very important cells. In the literature, in the clinical literature, they are mostly cited with negative reports, which is wrong. Without osteoclast, there is no healing. Without osteoclast, there is no bone regeneration. So osteoclasts are also very important part of the bone regeneration. And you have to understand also the biology, how bone should be, and osteoconduction and osteoinduction. But of course, surgical skills. You see, I'm repeating this. This is it's a must, and also a prosthetic concepts. So if we want to augment this in the anterior area, we have to follow biological principles. It means revascularization. If I want to put something here, whatever I am planning, if I am planning autogenous allogene or GBR or whatever, the most important thing is the revascularization. So you must understand from where the blood vessels are coming and which blood vessel do you want to have. So second, you must be able to have to active the regeneration. And third, the quality of regeneration, because we are working in the oral cavity. Oral cavity is full with bacteria. So we need a high quality of regeneration. That's why the bone on the neighboring teeth is very important, because from this bone, the vascularization is coming and the osteoblasts are coming and the osteoclasts are coming. So if the neighboring teeth had no bone, you must think about alternatives. And what we want to have, the original. This is the aim of our bone augmentation. That's why we use pure autogenous. We don't like to use any other material which will stay inside. We want to have the original. This is what God give us. Osteone with the osteocytes, with the Haber's canal, with the blood vessels inside it. Because this quality will influence the long-term prognosis. because we are working in the oral cavity. Don't forget this. This is able to resist against the oral flora. And look how nice it can look like after 3 months. This is vertically grafted bone. This reddish bone where the implant are placed, this is the guarantee for the long-term stabilization. I would like to show you a case treated for more than 20 years. You see here, this, we are missing bone vertically, 3D reconstruction with bone blocks coming from the retromolar area and the box form, the box is filled with bone chips. And after 3 months, it looks like this. Look how nice this looks like. Only after 3 months, we take a biopsy from this bone and we look under microscope. And we will see here already macroscopically, the biopsy looks excellent. But under microscope, already after 3 months, we have more than 50% new bone formation. This is the dark color, what you see it here. The clear color is the grafted bone and the dark color is the newly regenerated bone. You see more than 50%. So these two implants were placed in excellent situation. We see the case in the year 2000. It was not only this, this area, also we grafted the posterior maxilla and this posterior maxilla. And we see it here 21 years later. These are the two implants. This is the year 2020. And of course we have some remodeling here. We lost perhaps 1 millimeter on this one here. But look here, the patient is 80 years now. And these are the implant absolutely stable. And these are not only case report. This is our standard, my friends. This is what we see every day in our recall patient, if they are coming to recall, of course. So that's why our treatment strategy is reduce the risk, but the risk not for the surgery, the risk for long-term stability. This is the goal. The goal is the long-term stability. That's what we want to have. So you see, first of all, good diagnostic. Soft tissue augmentation is done very often before bone augment, vertical bone augmentation, like in this case. Look in the scar tissue, if you make directly bone augmentation, it will be high risk to have tissue necrosis with a lot of scar tissue. That's why before we make the bone, vertical bone augmentation, we have to improve the quality of the soft tissue for security here. And later after insertion of the implant, we are re-augmenting the soft tissue, but here is for aesthetics. So, and here I would like to show you an example. Look, this is the case, what we call DMD case. DMD case means destruction made by dentist, unfortunately. You know, this is somebody who makes some experiment on this patient. He augment with biomaterials, resorbable membrane, and at least this patient was 23 years old with a missing lateral incisor. Look how she looks like. So these teeth are lost, these teeth. So we have to remove everything. So we remove the implant, we remove the teeth, and we will never do the bone augmentation at the same time. Look to the quality of the soft tissue, very poor soft tissue. We have first of all to improve the quality of the soft tissue, and this is going to be done during the explantation and extraction of the teeth. We are going to photodynamic decontamination to do to decontaminate this area with H2O2 and photodynamic. And then we are going to prepare a palatal connective tissue flap here to be push it in this area to improve the quality of the soft tissue. Technique what we published already 21 years ago. So and look how it looks like now after 8 weeks. Now we have much better soft tissue situation. Now it's possible to augment the bone. We go to the retromolar area with the microsaw. We are going to cut a bone block here with our special protocol. And then we are going to use this bone to be grafted in 3D form, as you see it here. And after 3 months, it looked like this. And if we look to this point here and higher magnification, look to this. What you will see? You will see hundreds and hundreds of blood vessels coming to this area. This is inflammation, what we need for excellent bone healing. Because every time we are grafting the bone, some of the bone cells are going to die. Not all of them, not the cancerous bone, but some of the of this bone, of the cortical bone. And the dying process is a very important point for the regeneration, because through the dying process, you are exciting, you are make a provocation of the bone healing, and you will have a lot of expression of BMPs, bone morphogenic protein, to have this beauty for regeneration and accelerate vascularization. And at least it was possible to get this result, what you see here. And look where we start. We start with this situation, 23 years old girl. And this is what we were able to get with this technique. So we are trusting only autogenous bone for crystal bone augmentation. Biomaterials have only osteoconduction properties. We are using them, yes. We are using them in sinus lift grafting procedure. Yes, because there you don't need too much autogenous bone. The graft in the during sinus lifting is far away from the crestal area, is far away from the oral cavity, and they are a very good space maintainer. But for crestal bone augmentation, we need cells, we need survived osteoblasts, we need BMPs to have a good bone regeneration. And we have the mineral for the osteoconduction. And you can see here, if you don't follow biological principles and you make some experiment on your patients to try to augment vertically, if you don't have the surgical skills and if you are not able to use membranes in a correct surgery and in two-stage procedure, you can have something like this. And this patient, 28 years old, look how she looks like. And to get this treatment, it took time more than 1 year. Of course, a very difficult surgery, because not only the situation to remove these implants, the problem is the regeneration potential. When you have such an infection, you are reducing the regeneration potential of the recipient site. And so you are not going to expect an excellent regeneration as you are going to do it from the beginning in non-infected area. So you see here the 3D reconstruction, and this is what we were able to get 14 years later in this patient, and look, starting here, arriving here. What about allografts? Allografts are becoming today, you hear much more on allografts and also on bone from the bank. You know, I want to show you only this study from 2015 from Chapasco. You know, 68% complication should give you something to think about it. Not only to look to the cases where it functions, but 68% complication is something what is difficult to deal with it. And we have here a publication from Frank Schwartz and Atsi from 2017 on also on allografts on rabbit calvaria. And the problem is the revascularization. This is the problem. If you have no blood vessels, even if your graft looks quite well, if you have a very poor vascularization in your graft, it will be very difficult in the oral flora. Don't forget, we are working in the oral cavity. That's why we trust only autogenous bone, and it's still our gold standard because of all this. What do we have? And it costs nothing. Autogenous bone doesn't mean always heavy surgery, my friends. We have also possibility to get minimal invasive approach also with autogenous bone with an easy surgery. Look at this case. We are missing the bone about 12 millimeters. So we go with a trephine, and we are going a little bit more palatally. The implant should be more palatally. And we are going to get this beautiful bone core, what we call carota. That's why this technique, we call it Karota technique. So this bone core is the gold. It is from the middle of the crest. It is bone marrow. Look to the defect here, what we are missing. And we are going to graft this area. Of course, the implant should be inside of the bony contours. You see the threads? They are inside of the bony contours. Now we are going to cut this core in two, and it's going to be pressed with microscrews against the exposed threads. This is the situation at the end of the surgery. This is after 3 months. Look how nice this bone looks like. Look at this excellent regeneration. Starting here, arriving here, and this is the 5 years results. So the group, Reinhard Gruber, they looks on the microscope about this bone core. And they found that this bone core had a high osteoinductive properties. Okay, it's coming, of course, we were expecting this, but now we have also the confirmation, the histological confirmation that this bone had a very good quality for the regeneration. Would like to show you some more extreme cases. Here we are missing all the complete buccal bone. So we don't need always blocks. We can treat this with a minimal invasive approach by getting the bone core from the same socket. This is canine tooth, wide socket. So you see we are getting the bone core implant inside of the bony contour for the vascular supply and the primary stabilization of the graft. You see the bone cores are pressed here with microscrews. That's why we need microscrews, screws which are very thin. And look how nice this looks like after 3 months. And we see the case after 8 years and on the cone beam. Look how stable this bone. We don't need any biomaterials. We don't need any bovine. It's only vital bone, and vital bone will still there. If you are interested about the study, we have a 5-year prospective study published in this journal in the 2018. So if you are interested, you can look at this. So for this technique, we make with one company special instruments with the different diameter of tryptophan and with pre-tryptophan. Pre-tryptophan are very important because they are preparing the place for the tryptophan. The tryptophan is not going to dense. And these tryptophan are 2 pieces tryptophan. So in case where the bone core is going to break inside of the tryptophan, we can open it and push it out very easily. And so we solve all problems with the old tryptophans. So, and another thing, we need microscrews. Microscrews who are, don't take too much place, are able to stabilize this bone core. Look here to this case here, this microscope not taking too much place. Look how nice it looks like, and very good compatible here with the bone healing, good accepted by the biological area. But these screws are not made by titanium, because titanium in this diameter has not a good stability and is going to osseointegrate. And when you remove the screws, it's going to break. That's why here, this is microscrews are made with a new special medical stainless steel, allowing us to have very thin screws, 1 millimeter diameter, with special instruments to screw them, to secure them, so they are not going to fall down inside of the mouth. And we would like to show you a case here in the molar area. Looked at this heavy defect, about 12 millimeters a defect. We go first with the tryptophan burr, with a pre-tryptophan, with a pre-tryptophan a little bit more lingually. Then we go with the tryptophan to get this beautiful bone core. The implant must be inserted inside of the bone contours. And this is the bone core pressed. We are not going to screw through the bone core. It's pressed only. And look how nice it looks like after only 3 months. Starting here, arriving here after 3 months. And you look here to the 5-year result, starting here, arriving here after 5 years. Okay, but what we do with such a defect? If you have something like this, you can treat it with minimal invasive approach. You know, especially in the posterior mandible, one of the most difficult area to augment. So here we need blocks, and our favorites in the retromolar area from the linea obliqua externa. This is where we are going to get mostly our blocks. Of course, we can go to the chin or to the molar area of exostosis, but in many cases, we try to solve the problem with intraoral harvested bone. And we have a study published in the year 2015 in the JOMI, and this study received the William Laney Award in the 2017. It's a prospective study on more than 3,800 harvested bone block from the retromolar area to show you what for security, if you follow the protocol, our proper protocol, you can be very secure and get in very short time a beautiful block going up to 4.4 cubic centimeters. But this block is, from the native point of view, pure cortical block. Look how it looks like. 3-4 millimeter pure cortical block. And we made our own experience by grafting such a block. Thick cortical bone, you see, the remodeling is very low. Even if it's going to heal quite well, the bone is still white, very low vascularization. And if you drill inside, you see no bleeding. And you see, we published this already in the year 93. And I got the idea at that time from Denny Boozer, because he was looking more to the microscope at that time. And he told me, Fuad, this bone, if you graft it like this, it's a mostly dead bone. And he was right. You see here a lot of dead osteocytes inside. And after the bone, after the implant exposure, and this bone will have contact to the oral cavity, look what can happen. This bone is going to resolve. That's why we changed the protocol many years ago. And we go to improving the osteoconduction properties of autogenous bone, which was possible if you increase the surface. If you increase the surface, you will have more on the surface, more newly formed bone. It means that bone in this form or in this form or in this bone had much better healing process than bone with this form. But we need bone in block form at the biological membrane. So at least it is similar for what Uli showed us before. It is something like GBR, but without using artificial membrane, by using the bone itself as a membrane. So instead to use the thick bone block like this, we are going to cut it in two, or sometimes in three, and from one block we will have two or three blocks. Thin, we are going to thin it here with the bone scraper to get the bone chips. And you can imagine that the revascularization was going to happen with the cutting cone will be much easier to go through a thin block like this than to go through a thick block like this. So at least if we want to augment a whole crest in the maxilla, for example, look to the primary bone, the thin bone here, the blocks, the thin blocks what we prepared are going to be stabilized with screws on distance, as you see it here, at the biological membrane. And the gap, the box, is going to be filled with pure bone chips who have much higher bone regeneration potential. And after 3 to 4 months, it looked like this. Starting here, arriving here in a very short time, and look the beautiful reddish color of this augmented bone. So the biopsy is showing us from this bone a double more vital osteocytes after already 4 months, as with the classical approach. I don't say that classical approach is not functioning. Of course, sometimes it functions quite well, but not always. And you see, we have double more vital cells in this area. Soft tissue management is also very important to get a long-term stability. I show this at the beginning. This is the case where we graft the bone and we insert the implant. But look where the implants are now, are in the mobile gingiva. That's why apical reposition flap to get this situation and a situation 18 years of the patient stable, not only good implants and good bone, but also stable keratinization on the buccal side. So this technique, what we call split bone block technique or shell technique, we have a lot of advantage. I'm not going to discuss because we don't have the time for this, but only to show you more possibility for vertical bone augmentation, especially for vertical bone augmentation. And we have a new publication just published some couple months ago from this group from the University of Heidelberg. Very nice publication. They took the same block on the mandible of pigs, and they treat it with the classical form or with the split bone block technique with the shell form, the same bone volume. And you see the difference, what you can get with our technique, much more bone volume with the same bone surface as with the full block. A very nice study just published in the JOMI. You can look to it and it can give you the confirmation. So you see, this is also a problem after missed augmentation with biomaterial, a lady in the front tooth area. Look at the vertical bony defect grafted in 3D form. The situation after 3 months, look to the quality of regeneration. The two implants are braced here and look what we are able to get in this case. Another lady lost the teeth here after an accident. And look how we grafted in 3D form and where we need the central papilla. We had a vertical bony defect more than 12 millimeters here in the middle. So we grafted with the same technique and look how nice it is 10 years later. Absolutely stable results 10 years after the surgery. Posterior mandible, one of the most difficult surgeries to do because bad approach, difficult approach, thin lingual mucosa, and the bone regeneration quality is not so very good in this area. So you see the case grafted in 3D form, about 10 millimeters vertically. So it looks like post-operative. And you look here, the stable regeneration in this area. Look how we start and how it looks today after more than 7 years. So we correct also the soft tissue with the Kazangian vestibuloplasty. I don't have the time to talk about it today. So vertical bone augmentation is always risky. Of course it is risky. It is the most risky surgery. That's why in the posterior area, we are using many times, especially in smoker patients. You know, smokers, mostly of our patients were smokers or are still smokers. So how we are able to offer them possibility of treatment and reduce the risk? This is possible with the tunnel approach. So you see here, we want to augment the maxilla. We have vertical bony defect and we are doing only one vertical incision. You see it here at the end of the surgery. And with one vertical incision, we are able to make this 3D reconstruction in the posterior mandible. And look how nice it looks like after 3 months. This is the bone quality, what we are expecting. And the other side, the same patient, this is the left side. Look the amount of vertical bone augmentation. Second block is coming after filling this the box with bone chips. And we have only one vertical incision. This is the bone quality, what we are going to get. Three implants are placed here. This is the X-ray post-op 2004. This is 15 years later. Look at the stable bone situation and how it clinically looks like. We have a study published in 2019, a 10 years prospective study, also in the JOMI. If you are interested, you can look about it. I would like to show you an extreme case also in the posterior mandible using the tunnel approach. Of course, it's more difficult tunnel approach in the mandible than in the maxilla. Maxilla is easier. So mandible need much more surgical skills because you don't see too much. Look how the clinical situation was. This tooth was removed because we're losing a lot of bone, but look at the defect. Look at what we were able to augment. And the situation after 3 months. Look how nice the bone, the reddish bone. If when you drill inside, it will bleed, heavy bleeding. So correction of the soft tissue with the Kazangian vestibuloplasty, and you see the case after 6 years. Look how stable this bone. And the meantime, we augment and restore also the maxilla. Would like to show you a long-term result for the posterior mandible. Here, the posterior mandible. This patient had to be treated because of TMG disorders. She was treated like this, and she had a heavy TMG disorder. That's why the prosthetic colleagues asked us to get some support here. There were no bone. That's why vertical augmentation with a tunnel approach. You see the X-ray post-op here, how it looks like. And this is the result 15 years later. Look how nice this bone looks like. And the clinical situation with the Kazangian vestibuloplasty. If you are interested about literature, we have some publication, what we would like to show you here. Also, this is a publication from the group of, this is a group from at Mainz and Munich. Just published last year, 10 years results following this technique with a survival rate of 100% after 5 years. So many things what I was talking about, you find this in our new book if you are interested about it. So we don't have comparative study because I don't make experiment on my patient. That's why I can publish only our result done with our own techniques. So you can learn these techniques in the United States. The next course will be in May, I hope, in the Corona time. This is the next course at IDEA in the United States. We have also a lot of courses in our clinic when Corona will stop. I will be happy to welcome you there. And as I told you, I hope in the beginning of the summer, if Christian can confirm this, you will find in this 800 pages book, a lot of information to make your treatment better. And with this, I would like to thank you very much for your attention and to thank Quintessence for the possibility to present you this result today. Thank you.
So thank you very much. This was a great 2 hours with you two guys because it was very interesting. You have the same way how you define long-term success, but you have completely different ways how you augment your bone. And so first of all, I like to thank you for that information. And I also want to say thank you again to Tommen Medical because they were the sponsors of this webinar that we could make this happen. But when you remember the slides of Kuri with the small diameter implants, I want to tell all of the audience, I come back to Pierre Cardin. Implantology is not something what everybody can afford. So if you have no bone, you have to augment bone. And if you have to augment bone, that costs money and you need experience and that costs time. So it makes no sense just to place a small diameter implant to save money, because at the end, the patient pays it double. It makes no sense. If you want to make implantology the right way, this is a business class or a first class procedure. And so this is something you have to keep in mind. And we have very many very interesting questions. We start with the first one. This is a question about, according to Dr. Uli Grunde, the most important factor of GBR is good membrane to block out the soft tissue invasion. However, Dr. Khoury didn't place any membrane above the bone plate. How can you explain this situation? Perhaps Uli, you start, and then we have Professor Khoury.
Yeah, first of all, I would like to thank Furt for the great presentation. And I must say, if I have a huge defect and we have limitations with our membrane, I send my patients whenever I could, I will send them to Furt because it's really, you're the expert for doing this. But you know, there are not many people that can show what you showed. That's, I think it's an important thing that we realize. And yeah, about the membrane, well, it depends. You look, there are cases where Furt actually uses, he makes a roof on his augmented. You know, sometimes he has two membranes because actually, yeah, he uses membrane. He produces the membrane. And we discussed this different technique so many times already for them myself, you know. And I always say, well, if you use a membrane, you take the membrane out of the patient's mouth and I open a box. I prefer to open the box and he prefers to take it out of the patient's mouth. But I think it's, for me, it's interesting from him to know when do you cover your augmented area with an extra layer of cortical bone on top and when you leave it. Because I don't understand actually how it can function, the big augmentation without a layer on top.
Now, you know, when we make vertical bone augmentation, we have to reconstruct two walls. And these walls can be vestibular and palatal. And this is the physiological way. But when we are doing tunnel approach, we can't do this because we are not exposing. So the two walls are coming, one wall is coming on the top and the other wall is coming on the vestibular side because I can't reach the palatal side. And the palatal side, I still have the periosteum because we are not exposing the palatal bone. So the physiological way is the two bone walls on the buccal and on the palatal, and we are filling the box with bone chips. Okay, the other, the modification only for the posterior mandible or posterior maxilla.
So
when we are doing tunnel approach.
If I understand and I make conclusion of what the question was actually is that in a xenograft, soft tissue is growing in an autograft, no soft tissue is growing in, is that correct?
Some soft tissue can grow in, but very little part, because you know in your approach, you are expecting or you are building on the revascularization which is coming from the bone.
Right.
That's why you are putting the membrane to keep the soft tissue blood vessels far away. What in our approach? We want to have every bone at every blood vessel because we are dealing with vital material. And these bone chips need as soon as possible blood supply. And that's why every blood vessel is welcome in our approach. That's why we don't put any membranes because we want to have also the blood vessels coming from the soft tissue and coming from the periosteum, because our first goal is the survival of maximum of bone cells what we graft. If we put a membrane over it, big part of our bone will die because lack of revascularization, and then it will be the GBR. I have to wait longer until blood vessels are coming only from the bone. They need much more time. And that's why in GBR, you are waiting much longer until to get the good vascularization.
Yep. But you know, it depends again on the case. You know, if you have a huge defect, you go stage approach anyway.
Yes,
if
of course.
If you have a mid-sized defect, you have to go the staged approach and I can do it simultaneously. At the very end, the time is the same. They're correct. So again, I think for me, if I look at use cases always, for me, it's very interesting. It depends on the case. If I have a case where I can do it simultaneously, And you might not be able, you can do it with a small defect, but then I would prefer to go in one procedure and do it with a GBR. If a huge defect with the GBR we have, we are not successful. We mm-hmm. cannot do it. And then with the small defect, it depends what technique you prefer. That's what okay. I see.
With the small defect, I'm using the Carota technique.
You saw it. I saw it, yeah. With the Carota technique, you know, but you need enough remaining bone. If I have 2 millimeters of thickness of bone,
you don't do it. That's right.
I can do it simultaneously, and you can do it. I think it's really interesting to look at both presentation to realize that every indication or every situation might be ideal for this or for this technique. So the best would be if I learn your technique and you learn my technique, and then we have a huge range of what we can do.
I have a question to you. When you have a buccal bone plate and a palatal bone plate, when you have the two shells, palatal and buccal, then you fill this gap with your chips and you put nothing on top, no membrane, nothing. But I see very often that some people put a third plate on top. This for me makes no sense because you block the blood vessels. It is more difficult, and I don't think that this may help anything. If you get a dehiscence over this third plate, this gets a big problem that the wound closes itself. If you have only the bone chips and you scratch a little bit, it starts bleeding and it will close. Do you still put a third plate on top? I think no.
No. We were used to do this 15 years ago or 20 years ago. And we saw no really advantage. The problem is that sometimes at the end of the surgery, you still have some bone and you don't know what to do with this. So, and we were putting this on the top. But today, what we are doing, we are replacing this bone. We are replacing it at the area where we harvest it. And this is much better than to put it on the top.
Okay, thank you. But to have the discussion between you and Uli, in your slide, there was the sentence, you reduce your time. This is something I cannot understand. I love your technique, but for me, I'm not doing it every day like you do. But for me, the hardest part is where I get sweat on my head is when I have to take the bone. So we changed a little bit, and you see Aunt Hub is doing that too, that we get our bone shells from the box, and we only harvest our chips, what works very good. But Uli said that it's so important to speed up your time in your operation. And for me, as someone who's doing it not so often, it takes a lot of time to harvest the bone, but I didn't take 8,000 blocks like you did. So
now, important is to follow the protocol. If you follow the protocol really, because I have 8 residents, and they are starting to harvest the bone already at the end of the first year. And they don't need more than 10 minutes.
Okay.
But you have to follow the protocol. We have a special protocol. If you don't following the protocol, because some people, they see the instrument, they buy the instrument and they try themselves without following any protocol. So this is not something that can function. We have a clear protocol, and if you follow it, you will be very successful.
Okay.
And you can short the time a lot of harvesting the bone block. There is a very nice study published 2 years ago, a split mouse study. And in the study, one side was harvested with the microsaw, the other side was harvested with a piezo surgery on the same patient. And the results are really showing that with the microsaw, they need less than 1/3 of the time, but following the protocol.
Yeah. There was a question from the audience from Ala Khalil. He wanted to ask you, where do you get your bone chips? I think that's easy to answer.
Yeah, the bone chips are coming from the bone block. We are thinning the bone block with the bone scraper to get at least a thickness about 1 millimeter. And so we are getting the bone chips.
Okay. Uli, there's a question for you. You said that when you have these huge defects, it gets very difficult to do that with a membrane. What is your protocol? How will you do it when you go to the lower site and you have a big defect?
Well, even in the lower side, first of all, if I have a reduced amount of bone there, whenever I try not to do any augmentation, you know, with the short implants today, we try to avoid it. If I have to do it, I can do it with the membrane I showed you, with the titanium reinforced membrane, but we have limitations. But we don't need too much bone. We don't need 10 millimeter of implant length in the lower. We should work with very short implants if possible. But this is, as Furt said, this is the most difficult area. Yeah. And if I, one more time, if I have nothing left, I send it to oral surgeon. I don't do these cases. I see my limitations.
Yes, for me, it's always, I wonder how the Hungarian sausage can work so good.
But it's interesting. If you realize that they have now a new membrane on the market, which is actually also a PTFE membrane for vertical augmentation. So why do you need all of a sudden a titanium reinforced membrane for vertical augmentation?
Yeah, I don't know.
So. I know. Because it works very well with a titanium reinforced membrane, better than other things.
Yeah,
there was the sausage technique. I would like to add something. There is more than 50% of autogenous bone included. I think that's a very important message. And I think that the key is really to balance between xenograft only. No xenograft, like Furt showed you, or the mixture depends on the case we have to treat.
Okay, and there was a question to you from Nitin Francis. When you have a large defect and you need autogenous bone, do you prefer to scrape cortical bone or do you crush bone grafts? What do you prefer?
I prefer a little machine. Unfortunately, I don't have it anymore. It was developed in Los Angeles. It was a drilling machine. You can put it on top of the bone, an endless area, drill in, and it's just was harvesting everything that comes out. It goes very quick. And I like this machine very much. I have to find it again because scraper, hey, that takes so much time. I get furious until I have a bunch of bone. I get tired and furious. I don't know how people do it. It takes 5-10 minutes to get a little piece of bone. So whenever I have to, I try to take a tree fine and get some bone out and then use it crunched or not. What I most often like, and you have seen what we do, I actually take this cone because there is a solid piece of bone, most often 1 millimeter of cortical, nothing left, and rest is solid sponges bone, and I can screw it in and I have it as a support. That's my favorite.
Okay.
It's time consuming, it's terrible.
Okay. I have a question to you both, one after each other. When you do your procedures, do you prescribe the patient antibiotics? And if yes, how long? And do you start it before or after the operation? And what do you do against swelling? Uli.
Well, if I place only an implant, there is no antibiotics. If I augment, there's antibiotics. Is there a rationale behind it? No, it's only my feeling. That's very important to know. And then I give it for depends normally 5 days, sometimes up to 10 days. But after I finish my surgical procedure, unless you know people have any health problem and they need to take the antibiotics prior to it. And against swelling, well, they get painkillers and they help also for swelling. But we give the patients 5 minutes after I finish, they get the package of ice immediately. That's what we do.
Okay. Why don't you start your antibiotics 1 hour before you start your operation?
Why?
Yeah.
Why should I?
Yes, because when that at the time where you have your bacterial contamination, you are already on the antibiotics. And I think there's some pieces of literature say if you give one shot 1 hour before, perhaps this is more than enough. But they told me just hit him once and hit him hard. And if there's a big operation, just go on for some days. But to give it 1 hour before should be a very good opinion.
Okay, maybe I learned something. That's always good. But you know, sometimes people say, do you really have to take antibiotics? Then I tell them, okay, you don't take any. And maybe we don't see any difference during the healing. Because okay, if I have an infect inside, I think I have a problem anyway, maybe sooner or later. But yeah, maybe it's good to take it 1 hour prior. Do you have this literature somewhere? And can you send it to me? It would be very interesting. Thank you.
So, Professor Khoury, if you take autogenous bone, do you need antibiotics, or do you say it's not necessary for me?
No, of course, of course. And every augmentation, you should take antibiotics. There are very nice studies, comparative studies in bone grafting procedure with antibiotics and without antibiotics, and the results were clear. You must take antibiotics. The complication rate is very high if you are making bone grafting procedure without antibiotics. And the antibiotic must start before the surgery. We call it perioperative. So it means if we are going to give the patient oral, it must be at least 1 to 2 hours before the surgery. Normally we are giving this intravenously directly before local anesthesia, because local anesthesia is doing vasoconstriction and we want to have a high antibiotic plasma at the site where we are going to harvest the bone, before harvesting the bone. And this antibiotic must continue for at least 7 days.
Okay. We had a very interesting discussion this weekend in our study club, and we are all in there that we check the patients. For example, does he have a good vitamin D level? Because I think when you treat a perio patient and you do everything okay, and you see you have an ongoing problem, and you check the vitamin D, you will see that most times it's absolutely bad. And now we are discussing, does it really make sense? And I think yes, because we are taking care in our office of that you check the patients, not only of all the medications, but also for the vitamin D status. And do you do something to get a better status before you make big augmentations?
You know, we published a paper, I think now about 10 years ago, about the importance of vitamin D, because we were about, I think, 8 authors who saw in their complication cases that in these patients, there were a lack of vitamin D. And we found a relationship between low vitamin D and high cholesterol. So that's why this is what we are checking always on our patient before the surgery. When we are going to make heavy augmentation, or if we have a trifered patient after a complication, after losing implants, and we don't know why the colleague didn't tell us really information why the patient lost implants. We look always to vitamin D and cholesterol. And of course, we tell the patient to have a vitamin D medication and to treat his cholesterol.
Can I ask you, how long in advance you have to start the vitamin D therapy?
It depends on the patient. He has to control it before starting the treatment, and after 2 months, at least.
You know, Uli, if you have a vitamin D status which is below 70, and you know that you have to make a big augmentation implant, and perhaps you have a patient with a perio problem, you should check the vitamin D status. If it's below 60 or 70, you should see that you get the level up. And this takes about 2 or 3 months, and then you can go on. And I think this has a profound impact of the healing of the patients, because I recognized that all the patients where I had big problems, and we then tested them, they all have a very bad vitamin D status. I know this is this belongs a little bit to the green box, but I think it's... I think you cannot make a mistake if you have a good vitamin D status.
Yes.
No, and you also see this in this corona problem at the moment, no. that they have many, many people, when they have a severe corona problem, they most times have a very low vitamin D status.
Well, that means if a patient is referred to you with a huge defect, you check the vitamin D level first, and then you make 2 months treatment before vitamin D therapy before you start doing any surgery.
Before, when I know
a problem, nothing.
When we know that he has a perio problem, when we know that I have to make a bigger augmentation, I would always check this because that's not a big problem. We do it sometimes in our office that takes 10 minutes. And it's so easy to supplement this. That's not a big problem. But when we are with medication, there's a question to you, to both doctors. Do you do augmentation in patients with bisphosphonates? That's an interesting question.
Well, the question is what kind of bisphosphonate? You know, if it's a high doses over long term, I don't do. I refer. I always contact, if somebody only takes any bisphosphonate medication, I always contact the medical doc. I always ask them. And if they don't know anything about it, we don't know anything about it, I think. So if they have only prophylaxis and they get the shot and they didn't have a shot for 3 months, sometimes we wait 3 to 6 months and then we do it. But if they are just under medication, I don't do this. I have seen terrible things with that.
This is the reason when I have this problem, I send it to Thomas Hanser, this colleague of Professor Curie, and he will do it. How do you do it in your office?
You know, it depends what kind of bisphosphonate. This is very important and why the patient is taking bisphosphonate. If he's taking bisphosphonate because of tumor disease, you know, as a prophylactic against metastasis, so don't touch the patient because here you can't help him. You know, I tell the patient, I'm sorry, we can't help you. Okay, but if the patient is taking bisphosphonate because of osteoporosis, so the doses is lower what the patient is taking. And we are looking to the individual profile. So because this patient got tooth extraction 2 months ago, perhaps, or 6 months ago, we ask how it was the healing, did you have problem with the healing, and something like this. And normally the patient who are taking bisphosphonate for osteoporosis, they don't have too much problems. And in this case, we can treat them and we can do also heavy bone augmentation. I think 4 years ago, we published a study on 15 patients treated with oral bisphosphonate, where we made really heavy bone augmentation. It was published in the Journal of Nevins. If you are interested, you can look at the publication. We had excellent results. And we had less resorption because bisphosphonate is reducing the osteoclast activity. Okay, but not in tumor patients. Tumor patients are not for the office.
Yeah, I think this is very clear. This you don't have to treat every patient.
No, that's it. And not in the office, not for the office.
These belong to the clinic. There was a question where you can learn implantology. This is very easy to answer. There are many, many ways to learn this. You can look on the homepage of Professor Curie. There are many courses in learning implantology and to learn this augmentation procedure. And I think this is very basic to know how it works because you learn so much about how the anatomy works and how augmentation works itself. So look on his homepage and look for the courses. Another possibility is if you go on the homepage of Thomann Medical, there, for example, there's an international course for beginners. It's called My First Implant. It's done by me and my friend Sjurd Smekens, and we wanted to do it this year, but because of Corona, we have to do it in the beginning of the next year. There are also many courses from Uli Grunder. There are so many good people in the world. You can learn implantology, but start with easy things and you have to have a good concept. And perhaps there's one more question for you, Uli. A question from Irina. Is suturing the PTFE membrane easier than pinning it? Why don't you take pins? I think there's a misunderstanding because I know you both do both.
I do both. You know, I think it's not important. In most of my cases or anything what we do, many details are not important. The goal is important. Stabilize the membrane. If you can do it with suture, make sutures. If you can do it with pin, use pins. For example, in the vestibulum, to stabilize the membrane, always pins. It's so easy to pin it, and suturing is almost not possible. So with the palatal, it's not easy to pin most often, so I suture it, but suture it in a way that it stays stable. That means go very far in the palatal, where you have no flap released, nothing like that. So yeah, you have to work with your brain. That's it. So you say, well, I have to stabilize it. How can I do it best in vestibulum? Don't start suturing. Take a pin, tuck, tuck, and it's done. On the other hand, how can you pin on the palatal? Sometimes I can. I have cases where we did. Just make sure that it's stable. There are different ways to do it.
But Irina, just so I understand, all the membranes of him were pinned on the buccal side, every membrane, and it was sutured to the palatal side just to stabilize it. But when you see the second stage surgery, then you open just the flap to the buccal side, so you will not reach the pin on the palatal side. So the suture is easy to remove. And this is the reason why you can do both, pinning on the buccal side, suturing it to the palatal side.
Yeah, but if I may correct you, the cases where we have more than one implant, where we want to augment above the implant shoulder, they're always pinned buccal, that's right, on the buccal side. Single tooth replacement, most often, in most of the cases, we stabilize the membrane with the cover screw. You haven't seen, well, you have seen these cases, but I did not mention it and nobody mentioned it. So the cover screw is the best stabilization if you don't want to augment above the implant. And most of the cases, one cover screw and the titanium framework by itself, it's stable enough. Sometimes we make a pin in the vestibulum additionally, and sometimes not. It depends how stable the membrane already is. But it really depends on what you want to do. And again, if you don't augment above the implant shoulder, use the cover screw. That's a perfect stabilization.
Perfect. So time is running. And I thank you both for your lectures and for your time. And I have to ask my boss, Christian, are there still questions on your frequency asked questions? Or do you say no?
There is a lot of open questions that we couldn't address that I'm sure that were addressed in both of your lectures. And of course, these 2 hours is not enough to get into all the details. If you have further questions, you have an email, our email, if you really are interested, and we will forward them. But I think we covered most of the grounds. Yes. At least from my perspective, my humble.
Uli, is there anything you want to tell us more?
Yeah, it's a great format. I like it. And you know, I like to lecture with Furt, because Furt is he has so much knowledge. I like to listen to his lecture. It's not the first time. And Furt, I think it will not be the last one that we share.
I hope so. I hope so. It was also for me a great pleasure.
I have one more question to both of you. The next week, in 2 weeks, you know, the webinar which follows you is the webinar about the soft tissue. And I know today that there will be the sentence, if you have no bone, it's not a problem. If you have good soft tissue, do you think this is okay? I know that you have to have good quality and quantity of soft tissue, but I think only soft tissue is not the key to have long-term success. This is the last thing I want to know from you.
I tell you, the people, they are telling this, if I have a personal communication with them, they said, oh no, of course, I need a little bit of bone. So during the lecture and in reality, it's not always the same. We need, there might be a few cases where soft tissue is enough, but again, it depends really on the situation. But normally we need bone and soft tissue, for sure. What do you think, Gordon?
Similar answer, we need both.
So I think this is a perfect ending of this day. I thank you both very, very much, because I think you're one of the most experienced authors in the field of bone. And Christian, the last word is to you. Thank you to Dominic Medical for making this possible. And I'm happy to have you in 2 weeks back. Christian.
Yes, thank you very much, Fuad. Thank you, Uli. Thank you, Chris, for taking the time tonight and sharing your knowledge with us. It was great as usual listening to you. I shared in the chat the links to your publications, obviously, and Fuad, I linked also the article you mentioned about the PE-phosphonates. So I hope that people will find the information that they are looking for. So in 2 weeks, we see each other again. Chris, we will have Fickel and Zucchelli. It's going to be an interesting pair. It's going to be a lot of fun. You are more than welcome, Fuad and Willy, to join in. If you want to start the discussion again with them, you are more than invited. So looking forward to seeing many of you, also the audience. Thank you very much for sticking in. We have a lot of people still with us, also on Facebook. So thank you very much. See you in 2 weeks and stay safe. And yes, mine is empty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Yes. You guys have a wonderful evening, and Fuad, enjoy the soccer team, the soccer match tonight.
It's starting in 10 minutes.
Okay, that's where we're finishing now. Okay.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.